job, so thanks for having me tonight. And I'll start by kind of reflecting on some of the stuff that we've seen. The title of tonight's program was The City That Holds Us. And it started actually a few months ago when Faye kind of called me to a weird meeting in a hotel lobby with a robot that was kind of taking food from the lobby to rooms. And she told me about the Saintian city. And that resonated with me. And you will tell us a little bit more about that in a second, Faye. What mostly stayed with me is this idea of the city as a place that is not only an organism that has arteries that have cars flowing through them or have all these cells that might be residential units that have waste that is being taken out as garbage, and a city that's something that consumes and digests. But it's not only this infrastructure, which is kind of technical. A city also maybe has a mind and a heart, and it also senses us and also kind of transmits to us. And when I think about what humans have and what is the kind of trait that humans kind of bring to the world is compassion. That's something that humans are pretty strong with compared to many other animals. Some animals do have compassion, but humans have kind of mastered it, at least from my perspective. And so if our kind of biggest physical creation is the city, then what is the compassion in the city, and what's the place for that compassion? So this is kind of a small reflection for me. I want to start by asking you all to introduce yourself shortly. And also I will tell you before that that if you have something written down, pass it forward. We might read it anonymously. Faye, take it away.
Hello, it's me again. So my name is Faye Darmawi, and I wear many hats since we're talking about the city that holds us, many identities. So I'm the Film Festival Executive Director and Founder. I am a mom of twin boys that are 17. I am a sole proprietor of a affordable housing finance consultancy. Basically, I'm a banker for hire. I work for banks and community development financial institutions doing basically number crunching. I am a screenwriter. Let's see, what else? A swimmer, but not really good. Yeah. Ron?
I'm Ron Sundstrom. I am the Humanities Advisor for the Film Fest, and I'm also a philosophy professor at the University of San Francisco. And my research is on political philosophy, race, and justice and equalities. I'm looking at that right now, thinking about that a lot in urban contexts.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming to the festival. You could be in some other beautiful part of California having a three-day weekend, and instead you're nerding out with us here at the festival. So my name's Robin Abad, and like you, I'm a big nerd, an urban nerd, which you can also condense it to a single term, urban nerd. And I am an urban planner and designer by day and a landscape architect by training, and film and cinema were my first love. So I am with the festival because we're able to use the storytelling power of one medium to engage folks in the important issues that we all care about.
Hi, friends. My name is Omid Manocheri. I am a multimedia producer and artist. I also am a program producer here, and I work for a social impact agency trying to shift the role of, you know, capital and readjust our value system. That's definitely a little bit skewed.
I'm Susie Smith. I am a documentary filmmaker, but that means basically I have a million other jobs or not jobs. One of them is not a job, but what I care about a lot, working on this festival as a programmer. And I'm queer, I'm Jewish. I'm going to bring it back to some of the identity politics because I felt like a little bit that is what tonight's program was about is that we have a lot of different identities in the city and the different ways the city, I can be all of those things. And I will say being part of this FEST programming team has really brought that to the fore for me because, you know, I make mostly documentary films about places, and right now I'm making a film about the Lexington Club, which was the only dyke bar in San Francisco for 18 years, which closed a few years ago. Feel free to donate. I need some money. But, you know, it's like being queer is not the only part of me. It never was. I grew up in D.C. I have an interracial family. You know, there's so many things, and that is what I love about living in the city is that I can go a million places and be a million people, and I'll still be me at the same time.
Thanks, folks. Can you hear me well back there? I'm not sure if the mic works. Okay. We kind of sat together and brainstormed on all these thoughts and questions and things that come up from this program and generally about identities in the city. I can kind of connect to what you said just now, Susie, about being queer in a city and coming to a city that kind of adopted me, and that's Tel Aviv. And at the same time, it also showed me all of the other people who are not adopted or don't have a space to express their own identity. And I think that's something that many people who are kind of somewhat outcast, somewhat on some kind of marginal group, many of them feel this kind of fairness that they received and unfairness that others might receive. And that's something that motivates me a lot. And I just to kind of figure out maybe why I'm here, the Rampa Garden, the garden that you've seen, still runs about twice a month by different communities who live around there who activate the space. I came to study urban design here in Berkeley, and I'm here in Oakland. I live here, and I work for an urban design firm around climate change and other stuff. That's kind of the context. So I'll start by asking Faye a little question. Some of these questions you've already seen, and some you haven't. So I'll ask you, Faye, about this city that holds you. How does the city hold you?
Well, I think that the word that comes up for me is a pulse. There's a pulse in the city, and it's the pulse of humanity, and it keeps all of us going. I had this epiphany because I had major surgery in January. I had a double hip replacement. I'm halfway to Westworld. And the Wi-Fi that you're on is in my hips. So I didn't know this, but I was not replacing blood at a rate that was normal. So, and they didn't know this. And I was on heavy painkillers and kind of struggling. And what I was holding on to keep my consciousness and to keep my energy was actually the city. And I didn't know this until I was so appreciative of my room, which was in the basement next to the garbage truck pickup and the deliveries and the ambulance. And I just held on to those noises. And I knew that if I could appreciate those noises, that I'd stay alive. So I think it was, you know, partially the drugs, but I realized that that's how we survive in the city, and that's how the city helps us survive, is the energy that we give to the city gives it back to us.
Adopted, or maybe lost a part of your identity.
You think I'm going to talk about the Lexington, but I'm not. I think that actually, I told you this a little bit, but my identity changed the most when I got a dog. And I always, like, I've lived in San Francisco for just almost 20 years now, and mostly in the Mission Noe, and I've always been, like, obsessed with neighborhoods and how important they are. My family in D.C. is, like, big community activist types, but I didn't really know any neighbors because probably I hung out at the Lexington too much. But so then I got a dog with my partner, and I started walking around, and I had lived, we'd lived on our block for already, like, 9 years and didn't know any neighbors, and suddenly I met all my neighbors, and I know all their dogs, and I feel like I have this totally new intergenerational community in my neighborhood, and it's amazing, and I was like, oh, I was, like, looking for this for so long in San Francisco, and now I have it. That's the moment, so, and I love my dogs so much. He's really special.
What's his name?
His name is George. His hashtag is George Rules. He's very special, I promise.
Okay, thank you. Show us later. We'll find him online. Omid. Yes, sir. How has this, and doing this kind of official to kind of have a clear cut between people, it's a dramatizing effect. Omid, how has the city shaped you?
So I grew up in a suburb. I grew up in Orange County, and you know, it's kind of a stark contrast to the culture here in San Francisco. Not to say that I haven't seen a lot of that come up here now, but it really opened my eyes to all the things you don't find in a suburb, and it made me all right with it. You know, it made me realize that there's more to life than competing with your neighbors and having a nice car and being able to take, you know, your private vehicle places. I realized that, you know, those were all devices to gather capital and gather money for different interests that I wasn't particularly inclined to. And there was definitely a time where, you know, as I came out of high school, I might have had a substance abuse problem, and that got amplified here in the city for a while, and then I realized I wasn't in a healthy place to move myself forward, and I also realized that this city both has awful things and great things, and it's the decisions we make every day that dictate where we end up. So I kind of had this moment of, if I want to move forward and I want to, like, be a positive, good citizen, good person, good human, I had to make a change. And the city, like, afforded me a bunch of spaces and different opportunities to go engage with folks like you and be here and do this.
Maybe I'll go back to the suburbs. Did the suburbs shape you as well?
Yeah, you know, the suburbs kind of gave me this landscape to be a rebel in and to dissent in the way I acted. And I'm, like, really grateful for that. And I'm also really grateful. I grew up in Irvine, which was, like, the safest place ever. So coming here kind of jolted me, but I am very grateful of the suburbs to be able to, like, grow up there. Like, it's a great place to go, like, spend your adolescent years, but then you gotta get the fuck out. Like, you really gotta get the fuck out. The community there, the resources there, it made me want to bring those things to the people that don't have it. You know, when you're afforded all these things, and then you see all these people that don't have it. Yeah.
Thanks. That's a good insight to take from this urban suburban gap and we've been through. Robin, would you mind ways that you lost a part of your identity? Susie was kind of adopted, so maybe you'll lose something.
Wow. Yeah. That's a really challenging question, because when I think about moving to San Francisco as a 17-year-old kid, you know, with nothing, no friends, no family, you know, no one to speak of, my personal narrative around being in this city and this place is one of just of so much generosity and gain. So, what did I lose coming to San Francisco, or what has San Francisco helped me lose? I think I'm a little flummoxed by that question.
It's like an interview. What's your like bad trait? And
yeah.
Question.
Oh, I can easily answer that question. No question.
Stubborn, but I'm not stubborn anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I really learned from being stubborn.
I'm a hard worker. You're saying like job interviews.
Next question. I don't know.
I can jump in and say that I mean I surely lost my innocence. Growing up in a small town, moving to Tel Aviv, growing up in a pretty kind of, I would say, asexual environment, and moving to a pretty, you know, vibrant, young space where you can basically do whatever you want. So that's definitely something I lost, and that I lost. I lost my innocence.
Oh, you lost her.
Yeah. I mean, actually, maybe something I'm gaining is tools to regain it. I'm really working on trying to be naive and innocent, and that's something that the city gives, at least to me. But going back to maybe a specific moment would ring a bell, you know, that's my losing my innocence, is I would always, on dates or when I met someone, we would, you know, grab a beer, sit on a bench or something, and then sneak into construction sites. That was kind of my place. And, you know, usually in the past it was kind of easy to just, you know, move a fence or jump over some boundary and transgress a boundary into a construction site. And it was always dangerous because the stairs weren't built and there was these open windows you could fall out from. And it was always very romantic or just dark. And like one of the two. Sometimes both, but not always. And this was definitely something, like this kind of space is to me a place where I lost a lot of things. That's where I smoked my first, joint. That's where I did a lot of first things. So at a construction site, you know.
Innocence, Robert. Well,
shit.
Maybe I can try and take a crack at that question. I think I remember my first protest was here in San Francisco. It's not something as a kid growing up in the suburbs of Southern California, you happen onto a protest. Whereas here, you know, you can't walk around the corner without running into some kind of civil disobedience or another. And so I don't recall precisely what it was. I think it might have been an LGBT pride parade, you know, in like the early 2000s. And I distinctly remember the sense of empowerment that I gained, but also really just was able to let go of any fear, you know. There's a feeling of safety that I think, fortunately, at least in this part of my identity, I very much feel in San Francisco. You know, for a lot of people, there is still a lot of fear. There's a lot of anxiety because other aspects of our identity mean that we're unduly targeted. But certainly, growing up in not a super conservative, but in a pretty Catholic environment, and all of the stuff that you internalize about your identity being queer, or at least I did, was something I was able to divest. And that's something San Francisco as a place continually does, I think. Bring us together in public spaces was a huge theme last night at our opening program, where we were talking about looking at films about public space and protest. Being together being in allyship, supporting one another, holding one another here in this place, but also in the way that we're protesting now, especially holding, it's almost like we're holding hands with other cities across the world as we do things like the Women's March on the same day. So I don't know if I just subverted your question, Robert, but that's the best I could do.
The best parts are subversion parts.
Okay, good.
Ron?
Yes, yes.
Tell us, if you like, about boundary or border in the city that you secretly want to cross or transgress.
Wow, I wasn't expecting that question.
Somebody had to get it. You know?
Yes, somebody had to get that question. You know, I'm not that much of a radical, I'm sorry. So there's no like thing I want to burn down or some wall that I want to destroy. But there are things that I'd like to know a little better. And I like the boundaries that impinge upon us. You know, some people think that we only make sense of our lives within boundaries. We live in bounded communities, inside of families. You know what a family is because there's a boundary to the family, who's in it, who isn't in it, the Sundstroms versus the non-Sundstroms of the world. Same with groups and communities, and perhaps even with nation states. And we debate that, we're fiercely debating that right now, the importance of the social meaning that comes out of living together, the collective creation of meaning, and how important that is to you. I appreciate those moments living in the city, living in Oakland, working in San Francisco, and traversing many of the Bay Area cities, where that boundary gets really thin, and things without your permission, without my permission, not that I have anyone's, not that I have any permission to grant, come rupturing through. And these are important lessons where you pay attention and you wake up and you go, huh, you know, what's the saying about my life? What's the saying about our community and our social meaning? And now have we forgotten about that thing on the other side? You know, I'm not terribly curious about what goes on in those big glass towers of vertical money or the big concrete or the big behind the former Sears building that's now, I think it was former Sears building, that's now Twitter. I'm not terribly curious about that. But I am curious about the lives that are lived under the underpasses, under the overpasses and in the tent cities that are breaking the skein of our comfort constantly and interrupting our daily lives, those of us who can afford to not live in tents on the street. So I appreciate those. And so when I think about the other side of those boundaries, I think about those boundaries there that I'm glad to not, you know, I'm glad to not be on the other side. But I'm glad to know, to be reminded that there is another side and that we're failing in many important ways. I had this really amazing, I'm going to just go off now. I was in the Philippines. I grew up all over the world on American Navy bases, Japan, Guam, and the Philippines. Didn't come to the United States until I was 13. I'm one of these weird kids that were born during the Vietnam War to an American father, but wasn't claimed by the father. So I'm back then, that was before they had the term Asian American. So kids abandoned in Vietnam, in the Philippines, and Korea to American fathers are called Amerasian kids. I was one of them. So you watch The Officer and the Gentleman, remember that movie? Officer and the Gentleman, anyone here over 40, you know, you might remember that movie. There, the beginning is a sort of overly romanticized, gritty scene of the streets of Olongapo and Magsaysay Drive. That was where I was born. And so, but I was lucky enough to get on the other side of the fence. Pure, pure luck, right? So, fence. On one side is life, one side is life in the first world, as we used to call it, the other side's life outside of those comforts. And I got lucky to go on the comfortable side of that fence. But once I went on a field trip, because they take American kids off those military bases and you wander into what you call, in the military, you call the economy, life outside the military base. And so my mother, who's Filipina, partially Filipina, actually, packed me a good old American lunch, so she has no idea what that looked like. You know, Wonder Bread, bologna sandwich, Oscar Mayer bologna, and apple, and Oreos. And I was working on being an entitled American kid really early on, so I threw away the sandwich and the apple and the Oreos and got myself an ice cream cone, you know, because I was already participating in the privilege of being an American. And then this kid showed up who was my height, my color, in tattered shorts, and he picked my lunch out of the trash. And that's been my moral doppelganger for most of my life, that kid, my moral doppelganger. He's always telling me how I'm not measuring up morally, politically, right? And that's what I see in those daily walks through our city, through Oakland, those little reminders. Those are our moral doppelgangers. Those are people there saying, hey, where are your values? What are you proclaiming? That's the boundaries that I'm curious about.
Thank you, Rob.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll open it up if somebody wants to ask a question to some of our dear panel members and producers and talents here. It's a great question. I think if we go into the kind of idea of adoption that was part of that film, the 6261 film, you know, once a kid is adopted into a family, the kid changes the family. The family doesn't stay the same. And when a city adopts a new person, the city changes too. And even though, you know, thinking about the first movie, the really short one, The New York Woman, you know, she really quickly just lost herself and became the city. Right, and there was a moment she was like really happy, hey, I'm part of this thing, but then she kind of slowed down and froze, and she lost herself. So it's a good question. What's the magnitude of a city that erases the individual identity, and when are you nobody? I mean, I guess some cities and some places do that. I felt that in some places, in very big cities and very big. Very big streets, you know, roads, you're like, you don't count. And then, so I'm taking kind of back to the films, but going back to your more specific question about a neighborhood, I think it is, I don't know, maybe you'll want to jump in.
Well, it's the perennial tension, you know. San Francisco was the most beautiful and most magical the day that you stepped off of Greyhound, right? And whatever. Yes, it was Greyhound. I think, for me it was Greyhound too. And I'll just say, and then I can let my co-producers offer some thoughts too, that at least in my practice working in government, something that I observe is that it's all about whether or not you feel connected to or have agency in the change that's happening. Change can happen to you, or you can be taking part, and I think that's the central, really, difference in whether or not we're able to adapt to or just address change. And so the examples that you brought up in the two films are really powerful, you know, people taking agency, co-creating something with their neighbors, defining a goal or a state that they were all able to arrive at together. That's really different than a lot of the dilemmas and the polemics that I think we experience, in particular in this place and time, where so much of the change is driven by, you know, macroeconomic forces, seismic forces, tidal forces of capital that are washing over our city and our country, and we as individuals, and even as a municipality, are relatively limited in terms of our ability to shape those larger dynamics. So I think change is just about whether or not you feel like you are part of that, and if you are helping to bring it about.
This takes me back to talking about boundaries. So they were pointing out a boundary in time. There's like these holidays that are for the Arab kids, and there are these holidays that are for the Jewish kids, and that's a different calendar. You know, that's a boundary that you don't cross, you don't go to, you don't even know, or you don't participate in the other people's happy moments and obviously other moments. So this is a structural, systematic moment that somebody decided to construct the education system like that. And I think he is changing, I mean, by, you know, he says it much better than me, but by creating this option for kids to meet, he's changing something. And the city's alive, it's always changing. Like, something is always changing. And that's, I think, we have to start with realizing that, because people want to freeze things, like those taxidermy buildings. We don't want that either, right? So the city's always changing.
I want to add something. I just want to say, like, if there is going to be change, I think if you can be really thoughtful about the change and be like, is that the right thing to do? And if I'm going to do it, can I make sure that it's inclusive and I bring other people up? Is really important. That's it.
Yeah, I think what Robin was saying about, like, agency within it and, like, fearing change, like, I mean, it's very easy to see the power dynamics in the Jaffa neighborhood. So to say, like, Arabs fear change, well, they don't really have the power in that situation. So the knowledge of change and who's in charge of that change is really, I think, where fear comes from for the most part. So it's really, to me, it's not so much change, it is the agency idea, and that you're bringing everyone along together and thinking about people's, like, collective understanding difference and how what you think is a positive change might affect someone else.
But haven't we? I mean, people have
painted, and there is, but it was the city that painted them.
I think before the city painted them.
Not bus lanes,
bicycle lanes. People went in just like.
Yeah, that's different. Yeah, no, I was talking about their bus lanes that were painted.
Right, right. Yeah.
And there's
talking about bike lanes, bike lanes also started as kind of a form of activism and people saying, like, get rid of the car. And today there's a lot of pushback, again, also for bike lanes, saying, you know, bike lanes are white lanes, and they're aimed to get, you know, affluent people to get to work faster, rather than, and they only come when people already move in. So that's already been used. So I guess that, to me, that goes to how any form of development, if it's done badly, top-down, and only to serve some people, would be seen as an aggressive, oppressive move. Because a bike lane, you know, you could say, bike is cheap, anyone can ride a bike. You know, people who don't afford a car, it's cleaner, all those other benefits, but then people still see it as an intrusion into their neighborhood after 50 years that zero investment has been done. So I think it's more about process than... something they would anonymously want to share, and
but you're welcome to read your own if you want to, but we thought people sometimes audience participation is not, nobody likes to be forced into that.
Okay, so I'm just going to start reading because we have 10 minutes. Where across the city do you feel most yourself? I was born in San Francisco, and from the window in my apartment, I can see the hospital where I was born in this world.
Wow.
So when I'm home, looking out my window, I feel most myself. Also, almost anywhere in SF when I'm on my bike.
Thanks.
Yep.
A moment in a city in which you lost or adopted a part of your identity. I honestly believe that the sound of the ocean waves I listen to each time I end up at the beach is such a powerful thing that helps me forget about anything negative that bothers me and lets me experience the feeling of oneness with the creative source. On the other hand, whenever I take a walk on the Golden Gate Bridge, I start to think inevitably how much I wish I could be able to do that on the Bosphorus Bridge. Back in my hometown, Istanbul. So I lose myself at the beach and find it back on the bridge.
Where across the city do you feel most yourself? Listening to live music.
Hear, hear. I have the same question. Where across the city do you feel most yourself? Outside in green space, walking, looking at sights, mountains, at the water, at taller points in the city, at home in my neighborhood that I love.
What boundary in a city do you secretly want to transgress? I love this question. The path of least surveillance. As cities become increasingly more watched and recorded, I've always been curious to see where the boundaries of these cameras end and the paths through the city, through the unwatched paths through the city.